Welcome everyone. Wherever you are, whatever you are doing, whatever your circumstances are, we are glad that you are here, joining in worship together. A very big thank you to Sarah and Kira and Clara and to Jean for sharing in this worship. And thank you to you for being here as well. Today is Mothering Sunday, remembered in many different ways by many different people, and people with many different emotions about this day. It is a time to celebrate, it is a time to rejoice and to give thanks, and to recall as well the mothering, gentle, powerful and gracious love of God. So we come to worship, and we come now with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Lord, we come together. Lord, we gather in your presence. As we meet to greet you, open up our hearts. Lord, we are weary and we are tired of searching. So come and find us. Lead us, bring us back to you. God of grace, God of peace, God of timeless love, give us faith, give us hope, give us strength to trust in you. Amen. So now we sing that great hymn of praise, Love Divine.
Let us pray. Creator God, we praise you for you have created all things and lovingly made us in your image. Nurturing God, we praise you for the way in which you care for each of us, providing us with all that we need to live. Loving God, you are our companion and friend, guiding us and helping us through our lives, sharing in our joy and comforting us when we are lonely and sad. Forgiving God, you love us, whoever we are, whatever we do. Even though we often get things wrong, you are always there, concerned for our welfare, forgiving us. Forgive us for the times that we take you for granted, for forgetting that you are there. Forgive us when we do things that hurt others, especially members of our family and friends. Forgive us and guide us back to you. Bring us home again, Mother, Father, God. Thank you for your eternal love. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today your daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom come, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I wanted to say a massive thank you to Clara for her prayers today. I really appreciate it. So now we're going to turn to a song called Empty Broken, Here I Stand. And in the middle of this song, throughout this song, are the words Kyrie eleison, which mean Lord, have mercy. So as we listen to, and perhaps if you are able to, sing this song, so let the words of the song be our hope and our prayer. And then Sarah and Kira will bring us our Bible readings.
Take my arrogance and pride,
Kyrie eleison.
Our first reading is from Numbers chapter 21, verses 4 to 9, and I'm reading from the Revised English Bible. From Mount Hor, they left by way of the Red Sea to march round the flank of Edom. But on the way, the people grew impatient and spoke against God and Moses. "Why have you brought us up from Egypt," they said, "to die in the desert, where there is neither food nor water? We are heartily sick of this miserable fare." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them, and they bit the Israelites, so that many of them died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against the Lord and you. Plead with the Lord to rid us of the snakes." Moses interceded for the people, and the Lord told him to make a serpent and erect it as a standard, so that anyone who had been bitten could look at it and recover. So Moses made a bronze serpent and erected it as a standard, in order that anyone bitten by a snake could look at the bronze serpent and recover.
Our gospel reading is from John chapter 3, verses 14 to 21. It was night and the streets were quiet. Nicodemus crept quietly away from his house into the darkness to find Jesus. He had lots of questions to ask him, but he wasn't sure he was going to understand the answers. He found Jesus and they started a conversation, but in many ways Nicodemus was in the dark. Jesus said to him, "Just as Moses lifted up the bronze serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." But Nicodemus was confused and still in the dark. Jesus continued, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not die, but may have eternal life." Nicodemus began to smile as the light crept into his eyes. "Indeed," Jesus continued, "God did not send his Son into the world to judge it, but so that he might save it. Those who believe in him are not judged, but those who do not believe are judged because they do not believe in the only Son of God." The light began to dawn. As Jesus said, "The light has come into the world. People loved darkness rather than light because what they did was evil. For all those who do evil hate the light and do not come towards it, so that what they have done is not discovered. But those who do want is true, come to the light so that everyone can see what they have done has been done in God." Nicodemus left Jesus as the darkness of night was over. and the dawn was bringing the light of a new day.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you, Kira. And now our next song. Let's remember. For love's sake, God became poor and vulnerable for us. We worship God, the light of the world, who entered this world out of sheer love.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh, so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake. upon that cross. I'll never know how much
Thornton Road Junior School, back in the 1970s. And the famous Gerald Durrell, zoologist and author, comes to our school. However we managed to get Gerald Durrell to come to school is beyond me, but came he did. And there he stood in the middle of the main hall in assembly, and wrapped around him was this huge, enormous boa constrictor snake. Couldn't believe it as we came into assembly and we saw him with this huge snake. How we managed to get him, I've no idea. But regardless of health and safety, there he stood. And he encouraged us to come and look at the snake and to touch this snake. And he kept saying to us, I remember it, he kept saying, you know, snakes aren't so bad. Don't be scared of them. Well, I'm not so sure about snakes when I think about this reading from the Old Testament, from the book of Numbers, because it presents us with one of the lesser known stories from the Bible. And if I'm honest with you, it's a bit odd, isn't it? A bit strange, a bit primitive, a bit magical, superstitious, weird. Yes, definitely, it's a very weird story. And of course, what makes it even stranger, even more weird, is the introduction of the snake. Well, I suppose two types of snake, really. You've got on the one hand these real nasty, poisonous snakes. And then you've got this enormous, majestic, beautiful and awesome bronze snake. You know, it would make a great film, wouldn't it? It would make an amazing musical. Talking of which, I remember singing in a musical by Roger Jones years and years ago. And I remember it, centre stage was this snake and this reference to this Old Testament reading. It is that dramatic. And maybe it should be better known, because it's a story that is full of wonderful elements. It's a great production, and it's got a wonderful cast as well, particularly the people of Israel, wandering about there in the desert, grumbling, complaining, moaning about having to leave Egypt, about having to leave their old homes, and going off meandering through the wilderness. You know, I kind of think that they forgot just how badly they were treated in those days. The further they got away from home, the more they forgot just how bad it was. And there they were searching for a new and a new promised land, but they kept on grumbling. They quarrelled. They quarrelled with themselves. They quarrelled with each other. They quarrelled with Moses, saying that Moses was a really bad leader. And more than anything else, they quarrelled with God. So, understandably, God said, I've had enough. Right then, that's it. I've had it up to here with you and all your grumbling and your complaining. I've just about had enough. And whereas you might think to yourselves that God would say, it's all right, don't worry, I'll make everything better, I understand. This time the Lord says, there you go. So snake after snake after snake were created, and they each delivered their fatal bite, time after time after time. I told you it was a strange story, didn't I? Strange, odd, weird. And to be honest with you, I don't really like it. I don't like it because I don't like the way that God is portrayed. This God who sends out snake after snake, inflicting pain, and much worse, to be honest. But thankfully, to me at least, the story isn't so much about punishment, but it's more about the remedy to that punishment. Because then, in the second part of the story, we see this change. We see this about turn. So the people apologise. Simple as that. Moses pleads for them because, well, that's what Moses does. He's good at that. He's good at praying for his people. He pleads for them. And then God turns into the master sculptor by making this beautiful bronze snake. It's majestic and amazing. And it describes for us, it presents to us the God who is majestic and full of mercy, powerful and yet full of pity, lofty but full of love. That's what we see here. The snake, the serpent, becomes a symbol of hope. This dangerous creature, this snake, becomes an image of salvation. And instead of running away from it, instead the people of Israel run towards it. They run towards the bronze snake, finding in it healing and hope. I suppose, if nothing else, the reading reminds us that God is God, that God is uncontainable, uncontrollable, and that, you know, if you try to put God in a box, God will just come jumping out of it with power and yet also with mercy and love, because that is the nature of God. Now, trying to compare Jesus to a snake might be just a step too far, perhaps. But that's just what John does in the New Testament. And you can't help but see the link between the bronze snake being lifted up and set up on a pole and Jesus lifted onto a wooden cross. I suppose those early readers of John's Gospel would have put two and two together and seen it very much as Jesus lifted high on the cross. That act of sacrificial love. Now then, it all begins to come together, doesn't it? Now we begin to glimpse the heart of God. The God who loves the world so much that he gave his only son, so that everyone who has faith in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. God loves the world. Those words are everywhere. Car stickers, the side of buses, on t-shirts, mugs, everywhere. Possibly the most famous verse in the Bible. And what it tells us is this: Jesus' body, tortured, broken, is then lifted up as an instrument and as a symbol of healing and hope. Healing and the source of eternal life. The world, we are told in those few words, is the object of God's love. The world. Not just Lancashire or Yorkshire or the Midlands or wherever you come from, but all the world. And not just the church, of course. Certainly not Methodism or Anglicanism or any of the other denominations, but the world in all its beauty and wonder and pain and anguish. The world. The world in all its variety and difference and hugeness and smallness. The world. Loved and encompassed by God. And you know, even bigger than that, it's the cosmos, the planets, the stars, the sun, the moon, and everything else in between and beyond, all loved by God. So God says to us, look up. Lift up your eyes. Stop looking at your feet. But look upwards and outwards and see the world around you. See everybody in the world. Loved, cherished, precious. Be amazed by God's generous love. Be encouraged by God. God who loves us so much that he gave us his Son. God's love, God's salvation is for everyone. Not just the few, but everyone. Not just those who say and do and think and behave in the right way. Because no one person is outside the scope of God's love. There are no ifs and buts and maybes with God, but a simple act of faith. We are called to make that simple turning towards God, a moment of trust, as simple as that. And here's the thing, God doesn't want anyone to perish. But God wants everyone to know and to experience life in all its fullness. Not next year, or next month, or next week, or tomorrow, or even in an hour's time, but now, in this moment, right now. Life in all its fullness. That is what God wants us to experience. And that eternal life isn't just a one-off action. It is an everyday looking for opportunities to live by the truth, to come out of the shadows. And to trust. Today is Mothering Sunday. Well, yes, it's Mother's Day, but it's known mainly as Mothering Sunday. Remembering when people worked long hours and would manage to go, were allowed to go one day of the year back to their homes to see their families, to see their parents. Those who worked in houses or farms or factories were allowed to go back home. And sometimes they might take a special gift with them, like a simnel cake, perhaps, to say thank you to their mothers for all that they had done for them. And they also went with their families to their church, their home church, the mother church, if you like, to give thanks to God. For some, it was a time of joy. For some, it was a time of sadness. It remains so today, of course, for each one of us. Today does bring with it a huge variety, a huge mixture of emotions. But it is also today a time to remember the mothering, nurturing, compassionate, protecting love of God, who did indeed come to save the world. So just possibly, John 3, verse 16, could be more than a slogan, more than a fridge magnet, or a memory verse, but a plan of action, a way of living, a way of looking for opportunities to shine in our world, helping to disperse the shadows of sadness and despair, of loneliness and fear, and living out every day, every moment, the mothering, gentle, yet powerful love of God. Mothering God, you gave me birth in the bright morning of this world. Creator, source of every breath, you are my rain, my wind, my sun. Mother in Christ, you took my form, offering me your food of light, grain of new life and grape of love, your very body for my peace. Mothering Spirit, nurturing one, in arms of patience, hold me close, so that in faith I root and grow, until I flower, until I know. Amen.
morning, everyone. Welcome to our prayers of intercession and a happy Mothering Sunday. I remember last year Mothering Sunday was the first Sunday that our church closed due to COVID, almost a year ago, the 22nd of March, and we are still closed today. Heavenly Father, we remember today our mothers and how different Mother's Day will be spent once again for many of us, not the usual celebrations. However, we look forward to hopefully celebrating Mother's Day in our churches next year. Heavenly Father, we pray for all the school children who have returned to school this week, many of them returning after months away. We pray that they can enjoy some kind of normality. And we pray for all the teachers and staff that they may return to a normal routine. Help them to feel your strength and love. Heavenly Father, we pray for all the residents of care homes who can now look forward to a visit from a loved one. And we pray for all the staff and volunteers who work so tirelessly and give so much love and support to all the residents. Heavenly Father, we continue to pray for all the NHS staff who are working so hard to distribute the COVID vaccine. And we pray for all those who have lost loved ones to COVID, and for all those who are in hospital with COVID or with any illness, that they may feel your love and strength around them. We pray also for all those who are ill at home or housebound or at the end of life, that they too will feel your love and compassion. And Heavenly Father, we pray, for ourselves, that we may have the strength and courage to carry on in these difficult times. We pray that we will always know how much you love each and every one of us, regardless of who we are or what we do or don't do, and that our sins will be forgiven, now and forevermore. Amen.
Thank you, Jean, for your prayers. And now a few moments where we bring our offerings to God. Each of us is different. Each of us, of course, is of infinite worth. So I offer a short, simple prayer during which we bring our offerings, our gifts of money, as and when we can, of course, to our churches. And we bring ourselves. I was so pleased to be sent your lovely self-portraits very recently. So after this prayer, we're going to look at some of these drawings and appreciate them and remind ourselves that each one of us is special. So a moment of prayer. Lord, we bring our gifts, our money, ourselves, our hopes, our dreams, and our fears, and our fragile lives. Take us as we are, and help us to know that we are loved. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that everyone who has faith in him may not perish, but have eternal life. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, people who belong to God. Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love, therefore of loving kindness I have drawn you.
Thank you.
Be kind to yourself. You are fearfully and wonderfully made, beautiful, unique and loved, unconditionally by God.
Let's sing to the God of all love and hope and peace, Lord of all hopefulness. Let us pray. Loving Lord, help us to look to you in the places we go and in the people we meet. Guide us when the way ahead seems full of obstacles and shadows. May we always give thanks, even in the bleakest of times, and help us to shine in the world. And God says, I name you, I know you, and I love you. Go in peace. Amen.